They've been down before, twice. So they know how much it hurts. And they won't want it to happen again. There are signs that the Borough are stirring. It's just one defeat in the last four for Middlesbrough, and they've beaten the cup favourites in that sequence. We saw it here live, of course. Only Derby County in the bottom six have won this weekend. 3 points here for Middlesbrough, and things will start to look an awful lot brighter. Charlton shouldn't get into trouble. That's the bottom line as far as they're concerned. Gordon McQueen is with us. Gordon, just wondering, after the events here last season, and there was plenty of turmoil, are you a little surprised to see Middlesbrough not so much deep in trouble, but on the fringes again, and probably, if they don't get something here, dropping into trouble?
I think they're certainly on the fringes, that's for sure, but I've obviously picked up points lately. I mean, a terrific one at Sunderland during the week, and I've said all along that I think Middlesbrough will climb clear of it, because knowing the players, that I've worked with so many players here, and there's a lot of character in that dressing room, and I think that's one of the things that you need when you're in the bottom three or you're in a dogfight for relegation, and there's plenty strong characters in that dressing room, and I think that's what will see them in good stead.
Plenty of good players as well. It's not as though they are short or have been short. So why is it that Middlesbrough struggle in the manner that they do?
Well, they've not got the money to compete with other clubs. I mean, whether the supporters like it or not, there's not. Steve Gibson obviously has been supportive in the past, but there's not a bottomless pit of money here, and fans here have just got to accept that, as have the fans at, you know, places like Charlton, like they're playing today. There's not loads of money available, and if you've not got serious dosh, you're not going to be a serious challenger.
Mm. Juninho, Ravanelli, two cup finals. It was a glorious period at different times under Brian Robson. Did it raise the expectation of what a club like this can achieve perhaps too far?
Possibly. I think when we got promotion and went from Ayrton Park into this lovely stadium here, they needed to do something quick to make Middlesbrough high profile. Obviously, bringing Brian in the year before raised the profile. But then when we got promotion that year, we needed to do something and do something quick. And of course, Ravanelli, Juninho and Emerson certainly raised the profile.
Mm, but it didn't work, did it, ultimately?
Well, certainly not. I mean, I honestly believe at the time Middlesbrough Football Club weren't ready for them.
In what respect?
And we weren't geared up to catering for top-class international players. Certainly the training facilities weren't there at the time. You're training in public parks and things like that. And just maybe the rest of the team wasn't as strong as where it could have been. Mm. I would have liked it to have been.
And that spell last year when Terry Venables came, Brian Robson took, despite the fact he was still called manager, took quite plainly a back seat.
Yeah.
To the benefit of the club, was all that, or ultimately, certainly not from Brian Robson's point of view, did that work, but for the club, was it change at the right time?
Yeah, I don't think there's any question about it. I think, I mean, we're talking about Terry Venables here. You're not grabbing somebody in off the street. You're talking somebody that's managed England, managed Barcelona, and regarded as one of the top coaches in Europe. And at the time, I think it was round about last Christmassy time, we'd had an awful result at West Ham. We looked really, really poor, and we thought, well, what more can we do? We maybe need somebody, somebody like Venables, who was available at the time, come in, change your voice, change your face, and see what he could do. And Brian felt, I mean, a lot of people said when Venables comes in, Brian should have walked. Maybe he should have done a month or so after getting Venables in, once he's bedded him in. But I think Brian felt, with his input and Terry's input, the one thing Brian didn't want was leaving Middlesbrough as a first division club, and they never. I mean, Venables took most of the credit, as he was going to. If they went down, it's Brian Robson's fault. If they stay up, it's Terry Venables. It was in a bit of a no-win situation.
So perhaps those who suggested Brian Robson should have walked a little earlier were right. Were you one of them? Did you ever say, Brian, this is not going to work in your favour?
No, I never tried to influence any decision whatsoever. Brian felt it was the right thing to do at the time, and he was proved right, because we finished 14th in the league that year, and obviously, Terry was hugely influential in that. I certainly enjoyed working with him, as did Brian. But I think Brian felt all along that with him by his side and giving Terry all the information, all the help he could, it would help Middlesbrough stay up, and that was the case.
Should Terry Venables be here now? Forget the fact that they went elsewhere and ultimately had to find a manager. Could they have done
here,
perhaps a little more to have kept him here?
Well, he certainly should be in football. It's a complete waste. He's obviously very good at the media work, etc. But I still think he should be involved in football in some capacity. And obviously, they tried hard to get him here, but he just wasn't interested at the time. He much preferred doing what he's doing now.
We'll talk about Middlesbrough later. Come back to that. Manchester United, we saw them win at Bolton midweek. 4 goals. Beaten despite leading against Chelsea for so long this weekend. Beaten again. They're bottom and they're in real trouble. Derby winning in John Gregory's first game in charge. Bolton, despite going in front at St James's Park twice, beaten again. They're in the drop zone. Blackburn just outside. A better goal difference than Bolton. But it's not looking good for Graham Souness and the Rovers at the moment. Then come Middlesbrough. If they win their two games in hand, they'll go top half. Sunderland still falling, alarmingly. Everton down this weekend. Southampton, despite the point at Highbury, because Ipswich Town won again. 6 out of 7 for them now. And West Ham make up the bottom half. Then it's Fulham and Charlton here. Spurs, Villa, Leeds beaten today in our pay-per-view game by Liverpool. 4-0 at Elland Road, down into 6th. Chelsea go 5th as a result of that. Arsenal 4th, Liverpool 3rd, closing the gap. It's just 2 points now between themselves and Manchester United. Same games played. Newcastle, the threat, as Gordon was saying. They've played a game less, and they're just 2 points adrift. Manchester United still top, 51 from 26 the return. And that's why there's unease at the Stadium of Light. Sunderland haven't won in 6 now. That's relegation form. Blackburn with similar problems, just 1 win from 5. All those that are falling into trouble amassed at the bottom of the Sky Sports form guide. Spurs, surprisingly, just 1 win from their last 6 as well. Charlton sit 9th here, as they do in the Premiership. Ahead of them, it's Villa. Newcastle, just 3 wins from their last 6. Liverpool, Southampton, Arsenal, Chelsea and Ipswich storming into 2nd place. Manchester United just keep on winning. It's Middlesbrough.
McLaren keeps faith with the same 11 who got that victory against Sunderland at the Stadium of Light on Tuesday. Alan Bocic has returned to training but not considered fit enough even to make the 16. One change for Alan Kerbishley. Mark Fish returns after missing the last 2 with a stomach bug. Kinsler and Jensen, though, still out injured. Mark Crossley makes his 15th consecutive start, though Mark Schwarzer did come through 90 minutes of a reserve game this week as he recovers from a hernia operation. Gareth Southgate and Jonathan Greening have been ever-present in the league for Boro this season. Gianluca Festa keeps his place despite his sending off for an alleged spitting incident at Sunderland. Franck Queudrue's Boro debut came in the 0-0 draw at the Valley in October. Phil Stamp made his first league start for 9 months on Tuesday. He keeps his place today. It's 4 goals in the last 4 games for the resurgent Noel Whelan. 19-year-old Brad Jones is the reserve keeper today as Marlon Beresford has gone on loan to Burnley. Dean Kiely and Chris Powell are ever-present in the league for Charlton. Portuguese international George Costa and 21-year-old Jonathan Fortune start alongside Mark Fish in a commentator's dream defensive lineup: Fish, Costa, Fortune. Graham Stuart, who missed a pen in the cup defeat to Walsall last week, continues to captain the side in the absence of Mark Kinsella. Chris Bart-Williams grabbed his first Premiership goal for Charlton on his first Premiership start for Charlton to beat Derby on Tuesday. Top scorer Jason Euell has 4 in his last 7, but none in the last 3, and Jonathan Johansson hasn't scored since bagging 2 in the 4-4 draw with West Ham in November. Young Paul Konchesky drops down to the bench. They're the team details, Richard. Back to you.
If we're in that sort of mood, let me just tell you that Gordon said he saw Fish play last week and thought he might just be a little bit out of his depth. It's the Riverside today. It's Middlesbrough against Charlton. We haven't spoken much about Charlton yet, but we will when we come back. And also, we'll look back on a very interesting January. That's next on a Super Sunday. Right now, it's Middlesbrough against Charlton. Just a reminder for Sky Digital viewers, the form guide for today's match is available now on Sky Sports 1. Simply press the red button on the remote and Sky Play will be available on Sky Sports 1 a little later, around about 1:30. Welcome to February, and let's hope it's as good as January was. Arsenal couldn't get the win.
Arsenal, as I say, you look at the players that they've got and they just can't get results at home. Their away form's fantastic as well. And yet with Henry, Wiltord, I'm never quite sure whether they've got it right up front, Arsenal. I'm not sure whether Wenger knows what his best partnership is. It's certainly Henry and A another. Is it Bergkamp? Is it Wiltord? Canu? I'm not sure.
That's the way they play, isn't it? It's a little bit French, isn't it? But they keep scoring, and up until yesterday, they had kept winning. Now, Charlton, the wheels were threatening to come off. They'd lost their previous three prior to a big win over Derby County in midweek. They needed this, didn't they?
Well, certainly after the cup tie against Walsall, which was a really poor result at home, getting knocked out of the cup. And although everybody's beaten Derby away from home, I mean, their away record's, it's abysmal. And they'll need to improve in that Derby County if John Gregory wants to keep them in the league. But that is an important, I think this is a great bit of work by Malcolm Christie early on in the game, and Dean Kiely makes a terrific save with his feet. But it was an important result. But Charlton are one of those clubs that, now how far can they go? I mean, we're watching this, the winning goal here, Bart-Williams. Where does the wall go? But it goes into the back of the net, so I don't suppose the end in the Charlton side are worried too much. But they're just one of those clubs, how much can you achieve? And you're not sure.
Because well, how much should they be achieving?
Top 10 finish, and I think Charlton fans, I know the board of directors should be absolutely delighted with the job that Alan Kirbyshley is doing. I mean, you can maybe pick up a cup if you get lucky, Worthington Cup, FA Cup. Maybe do what Ipswich did last year, climb up the league a bit and get into Europe. But yeah, with the resources, they're limited to what you can achieve.
Alan Kirbyshley is with Jeff Shreves.
Alan, how important is it that you pick up where you left off against Derby?
Yeah, we need to. I think everyone in the middle of the table is looking at every game. I saw some interviews with managers last night saying that, you know, if you're in the middle of the table, you're looking behind you to see what's going on, and if you're in the middle of the table, you can put a run together, you're looking above you. And we're in that position, so if we can get anything today, it will keep it going.
How do you see yourselves talking about being in the middle of the table? Are you looking at Europe or looking not to get sucked into relegation?
Well, no, I'll be honest that with the problems we've had at the start of this season, with the injuries and everything else, I think they've done fantastic to get where they are at the moment. And we've got an opportunity to perhaps do what we've done last year. If we get anywhere near what we've done last year, I'll be delighted. But the first priority is obviously, and I think 14 clubs are in the same boat, is to stay in the Premiership. So that's what we're after first. Anything else is a bonus.
What do you think points-wise is going to be the safety mark this year?
I don't know. You'll have to ask Mervyn Day. He's a stats man. But it's different last year. I think, you could have stayed up on 36, 37. The year we went down, we got 37, I think. Who knows what it's going to be? You just got to make sure that you're not in it.
What do you say to your players in terms of their mentality going into games, in terms of other teams struggling, also saying, look, what you've done with so many injuries?
Well, we've been criticised recently. We've not, we've got beat by Walsall, quite rightly so, but our run ain't that bad, our last 10 games. We let ourselves down badly at Blackburn, really our last away game, and if we perform like that, we've got no chance today. If we do anything like we know we can, we'll give ourselves an opportunity to pick something up.
You welcome back Mark Fish. How big a bonus is that for you?
Well, to be honest, it was a difficult decision because he was out and so was Luke Young for the game against Derby, and we reshuffled the back, and young Paul Konchesky played at the back for me, and he's played in most games this season. He's done fantastic and really was the player on the night, but I've decided to change it. I hope it works. I think everybody, even Paul, would hope it works because it's a team game. So Mark Fish comes back. I don't think Luke is 100% right yet, so he'll be on the bench.
Your thoughts on Middlesbrough? They're on a good little run at the moment.
Well, people have asked me about Middlesbrough this week and their dangers. I think it's the team. I think that they've consolidated, they've realised that there's a bit to do, and I think it's the team that's come to the front more than any individual at their side at the moment. So they're in a decent run themselves, beating Man United and then going to Sunderland winning. So we know we've got a game on our hands here today, but I'm sure that Steve will know that if we perform, he's got a game.
We'll wish you well. Thanks, Al.
Thank you.
No conversation about the vacancy at Aston Villa. Alan Kirbyshley has drawn a line underneath that, and that's wise, particularly on a match day, but it doesn't stop us speculating. You can understand, if indeed there is interest from Aston Villa, why there should be, can't you?
Yeah, well, I think his name seems to crop up when there's any vacancies with any of these clubs, talking Aston Villa, Sunderland, Everton, West Ham at the summer, obviously, but why move? Unless one of the big ones come in for you. Your Liverpool's, Arsenal, Chelsea, Leeds. Why move? I mean, are Aston Villa or any of these other clubs that we mentioned there, West Ham, any different to Charlton and what they can achieve financially? As we're talking all the time now, it seems to be money. But
well, you keep posing these questions,
yeah, but there's
then
no question
to ask you. So are they then?
There's no questioning clubs are tightening their purse strings just now. I don't know whether they're frightened at the money for television drying up or whatever, but they don't seem to be going to throw the big wages around. You look at people like John Carew and Dwight York, clubs like Fulham going, oh, wait a minute, we're not paying Middlesbrough, we're not paying these type of wages for these players. And clubs are definitely tight in their purse strings.
Charlton are tidy financially. Does that make that those who aren't spending, and you've mentioned, does that make them in 2 to 3 years the stronger, the bigger, the better clubs?
Well, it's happening just now. There's an elite in the Premier League just now, nearly with your top six. And you just wonder how the teams below, particularly teams like Charlton, are going to bridge that gap. There's only so far Alan Curbridgeley can take them. And I think the Charlton fans realise that they're not going to be pushing for a Champions League squad. As I said, maybe Europe. Maybe a little cup run, little cup win here, but not any more than that. And he keeps getting linked with these jobs, but he keeps turning them down. He seems perfectly happy where he is.
They're not spending big money. They have on Euell, of course, pre-season. But Bart-Williams here, the latest that Alan Kirbish has gone out and found that somebody else probably can't afford to pay. So he's on loan at the Valley until the end of the season, but it's a player with a wealth of experience he's got, isn't it?
Well, I think Alan Curbish is on a winner there. You're obviously getting an experienced player, as you've just mentioned, Forest, who are in dire financial straits because they're one of the clubs that have overspent a couple of years ago and they're paying the penalty now, and they've got to let people like Bart Williams go, who could be doing a smashing job in the middle of the pack for Notts Forest. He's now doing a good job in the middle of the pack for Charlton Athletic. And it's just, as we say again, it's Alan Curbishley been prudent. I mean, you've got an experienced player sitting in the middle of your park, and fair enough, you might have to play him a few quid in wages, but you've got him for nothing. It is okay between now and the end of the season, you get him for nothing, no fee attached at the end of this season. And clubs like Charlton have got to be looking more and more at the Bosman ruling.
It was big money by Charlton standards for Jason Euell, 3 in his last 5 in the league.
Well,
he's starting to find some form, isn't he? Was he one of those that, as you look about, say, 12 months ago, you're looking for a big fella, striker, someone who can score goals? He fell into that bracket, did he?
What question? I mean, at Middlesbrough, we watched him often enough, and all our scouting reports were always very good. We spoke to lots of other managers, as you do when you're checking up on a player, and everybody gave this boy glowing reports. Now, Alan Curbishley, obviously, has done his homework as well, because they don't splash out, what was it, nearly £5 million for this lad, because he, as we're saying again, he's got to make sure he can't afford the £5 million mistake, and this guy isn't. I mean, as you mentioned, he had an indifferent start to the season with Charlton, but he's big, strong, athletic, and he can score goals like that, which he did against Derby County. I mean, that was a fantastic goal. And you look at his pace here, and a good finish, and he scored what, 7 league goals, is it, for Charlton already? Showing good control there against Blackburn and a tidy finish. So he's been an excellent signing. Important signing for Alan Curbishley with the money involved, but an excellent one as well.
Graham Stuart scoring goals all of a sudden, 3 in his last 8 in the league. Could have been more had he converted penalties, of course. He's lost that job. But again, when you're talking experience, for not much money,
he's got
that's
plenty,
a student.
Yeah. He's got plenty. He's a bit of a, what you'd say, an unsung hero in the middle of the pack for Charlton Athletic. It's a bit like, I don't know, Robbie Mustoe at Middlesbrough, would you say? You know, gets on with his job every week, puts in a high level of performance every week, scores goals from the middle of the park as well, and more importantly, as the modern-day midfielder's got to do just now, there's more than a share of defending as well. Good tackle there and setting up the play. But he's another one that's, since I've signed for Sheffield United, has been an excellent signing. Excellent.
So a penalty saved, of course, by Peter Schmeichel, put the rebound in, but then
well, see,
big miss against
Walsall. Well, that's a great play for a midfield player, that. Going and supporting your strikers. There's a little ricochet in the box, bang, he's pounced on it, got a goal. I mean, it's hard work doing that, but he's a kid that's prepared to work hard.
£1 million brought Dean Kiely to the club from Bury. 31 now. Player of the month in 4 consecutive months at Charlton. What does that tell you? That he's been busy?
No, well, I'll tell you what, it tells you he's been excellent. And I think, I mean, you don't hear a great deal about Dean Kiely, but I think if you ask any of the Charlton Athletic fans, I don't think they'd swap him for many round about the Premier League, this lad. And I mean, goalkeeper's is, Brian Clough used to say about Peter Shelton, priceless, can save you 12, 15 points a year. Well, I tell you what, I think this lad comes into this category. It really has been an outstanding signing from Bury. As you can see, they're very, very athletic, very alert as he is here. And you see him doing a lot of that, saving stuff with his feet and his leg. That's a reaction save. But there's plenty of stuff stopping his feet, his legs, his shins, which, well, goalkeeper, you use every part of your body, you don't, and he certainly does.
And he's young for a keeper, isn't he?
Well, young in goalkeeping terms, you can continue for years now, you can get right into your mid-30s and longer.
It's the Riverside for us on a Super Sunday, Middlesbrough and Charlton today. Boro just beginning to find a little form. Charlton won in midweek, and they'll want to follow up that. And they've been difficult on the road as well this season. When we come back, tea for two. Claire Tomlinson meets Noel Whelan. Right now on a Super Sunday at the Riverside, it's Middlesbrough against Charlton. Just a reminder again for Sky Digital viewers, the form guide for today's match and Sky Play are both available now on Sky Sports 1. Simply press the red button on the remote control. Steve McLaren is talking with Claire Tomlinson.
Big win against Sunderland in midweek, Steve. Is that the turning point your season on the back, you think, of the cup victory as well?
I mean, it's a good week so far for us, but by no means have we turned the corner. We still need a few more victories before we do that. But certainly confidence and self-belief, you know, after beating Manchester United and Sunderland, should be high. We're looking to continue today.
It's the same team that you picked against Sunderland today?
It certainly is, yeah.
Tell us about that.
Well, obviously they've performed so well in the last two games, and we've settled on a system. The players are performing very well. We're looking solid at the back, and Noel Whelan, of course, up front, is on a hot streak at the moment.
I know after the Sunderland game you were furious with Gianluca Festa for his sending off, but you have decided to keep him in the starting lineup.
Yeah, we've had a chat about it. He's apologised to the team and myself and everybody involved, and knew that. He let the team down. He's accepted his punishment, and we move on. You know, I'm not going to cut my nose off to spite my face. Everybody makes mistakes, and Luca, again, we've just closed the incident, and he's back in the side today.
As you say, Noel Whelan is in fine form. Some of the fans hoping they might see Alan Bocic again today, but he's not even in the 16.
Very close to actually being on the bench, but he needs a few more days training, and. We play Leeds next week, so he should be available for that.
You said it was a very close game against Charlton at the Valley. What are you expecting from them today?
Another tough game. They had a good win in the week, which sent them to 32 points, which relative safety. They can see the finish line. It's tough. I remember the first 20 minutes at the Valley, we could have easily been 2 or 3 down. We expect the same again today. They're a good away team, well organised, hard working. Every respect for them, and you know, but the home form at the present moment is very good. We have to continue it today.
Just 1 point off the relegation zone at the moment, but those crucial 2 games in hand, which could lift you right up the table.
Well, you have to win them, and we're looking forward. This is the third game in a week. We've won the first two. Another victory will set us well on the way to that.
Do you have a points target in mind, Steve?
We don't really. Obviously, everybody looks to 40 points. At the present moment, we're probably looking at 44, just to make sure. We're on target for that. A win today will really set us on our way.
Good luck today.
Thank you very much.
Is it the first rule of survival, Gordon, that you've got to win your home games?
I don't think there's any question about that. I mean, it was always regarded as a bit of a fortress here at Riverside Stadium. We always fancied our chances against the Emery, Chelsea, Liverpool, Arsenal, and got great results against them. But that hasn't been the way in the last couple of years. Obviously, we're very disappointed at home last year.
Only 4 wins all season long. It must have been miserable about the
well, it was.
I mean,
you've got a great atmosphere here with a full house, but when things aren't going well and they turn against you a bit, players get a bit nervous and a bit twitchy, and that's why it's like so important to win today's game. And you look at teams like Bolton, we're talking about needing to win games at home. They've only won twice at home this season, and you begin to worry a little bit about Bolton simply because of that statistic.
They conceded 11 in their first 4 Middlesbrough. It's only 3 in the last 6 as they warm up in Well, time-honoured McLaren fashion. Well, they never had the best of starts,
Richard. I mean, you're talking Arsenal at home in the first game. I mean, that's just a game that you don't want when they're flying at the start of the season. And they took four goals off them. But what's been interesting is he's tinkered with their system a little bit. I mean, Boro got a lot of stick last season for not playing 4-4-2. The fans wanted two wide men bombing down the wings and whizzing balls in for Ricard and Boxic. Well, McLaren's tried the 4-4-2 this year. Sometimes it's worked, and most times it hasn't. And it was interesting last week against Manchester United. Half-time, 4-4-2 the first half, changed it to a back five the second half, and they went out deserved winners against Manchester United. And they played the same system at Sunderland, got a victory, and they're playing the same system today, five at the back.
Has one of the stars of this season been Gareth Southgate?
Oh, I don't think there's any question about that. I was surprised when there wasn't a host of clubs. I mean, he was available, he seemed to be available at Villa for, well, quite some time, and nobody seemed to come in, or whether they were asking too much money or not, I do not know. But he is absolute blue chip. When Steve McLaren signed him, you know you're getting somebody that's going to be rock solid, top draw performances, week in, week in, week out. And he's been a fantastic signer for Middlesbrough this
year. Quite literally week in and week out, because he's also one of only two ever presents. He doesn't miss games, does he?
Well, I know, when you're you maybe look at older players, well, not older, he's what, 30, 31, and you worry about, did he get injuries? He doesn't. And it's a really high level of performance you get from him every single week. And he has been a crucial signer for Middlesbrough. I think he quite likes playing in a back three as well. What about this for a recovery tackle? Fantastic. But he's one of them that likes playing in a back five as well. He played in that system for Villa for a long, long while, and maybe suits him a touch better than a back four. Although a good player like him should be able to play anywhere, and he can. He can play in a flat back four.
He started against Sweden for England. Would you consider starting him as the World Cup creeps up?
No question. I'd have him on my side alongside Ferdinand. He's having an outstanding season. He'll most definitely be in the squad. I don't think there's any question about that. And obviously a lot can happen between now and the end of the season, but if you're picking an England team for a midweek game, well, Southgate's got to be in it.
Noel Whelan's found some form. Didn't have a pre-season, got injured, but has worked hard to get himself fit again. He's scoring goals regularly, probably in the best form of his life, after a number of changes during his career.
In a decade of top-flight football, Noel Whelan has experienced as many bad times as good. But right now, things are definitely looking up.
I'm feeling good about my game right now. You know, I was excited about getting back and playing again. And I don't think I expected to have the start that I've got right now. You know, with the five goals in eight games, I mean, that's just really, you know, made me happy about my football, and my confidence is up there right now.
Does it seem a long, long time ago since you were beating Manchester United in the Youth Cup final back in 1993?
Yeah, that was. Still remember the evening. One of the best games of my career so far, I think. And you know, highlight I look back on and fond memories.
Do you remember who was in the United team that day?
Yeah, I think there was Beckham, Butt, Scholes, two Nevilles. So there's ever a strong side out, and you know, a side that's gone on and done really well and played for the country.
What did it feel like? You know, you've just won the Youth Cup, you're in the under-18 England squad, you've got a European Championships on home soil. Do you kind of feel like you've got the world at your feet at that point?
Yeah, you know, you feel good and you feel happy. You know, it's something as a child you only dream about. You know, to win the FA Youth Cup was fantastic. And then to be called up and even to be involved, you know, with the players that were in the England squad at the time, you know, it was a real dream for me.
Did you ever think to the future at that point?
I think it's just a present. You know, everything was really good for me at that time. You know, my football was going well, and you know, I was playing for Leeds, who I'd supported all my life. So, you know, at the time, I couldn't really ask for anything more.
But opportunities at Elland Road were limited, and his potential was held back. So, in December 95, a £2 million move to Coventry City saw him reunited with his mentor, Gordon Strachan.
I think my time at Coventry started off well, and then, you know, had a few ups and downs while I was there, and I couldn't have asked for anybody, you know, else to take me through that time of my career than Gordon. So I made a lot of childish mistakes, which, you know, you get stronger by learning by. I learned the hard way, and hopefully it's made me a better and stronger person coming out of it.
Do you have any regrets?
Yeah, I think you always have regrets. You know, you always look back on some things and, you know, think to yourself, what the hell were you doing there? But, you know, that's just part of life. You know, you're young, and, you know, to get stronger, you've got to make mistakes.
What did Gordon Strachan actually do for you?
Well, Gordon, he was always there, not just as a manager, but as a friend to me, and still is. He took me into his house when I needed a family. I wasn't feeling too good about myself during that time, and my football before I moved in with Gordon wasn't going great. But when I moved in with him, you know, everything started falling into place. I felt more relaxed, you know, better about myself, and that showed on the pitch. And I was playing the football that I knew I could play.
Now back on track and free from injury, Noel is enjoying the form of his life, but he's only too aware that he still has to win over his critics.
Some would probably say I've not fulfilled everything that I should have done, which is true. And, you know, hopefully some people say a good striker with promising future ahead of him.
Do you really think that you haven't fulfilled your potential?
I do in some aspects, yes. You know, I've, especially at Coventry when I had an up and down time there, you know, that was my time really, you know, to knuckle down and try to break through into the England side, hopefully, and, you know, further my career. Didn't happen, but, you know, you live and learn. Hopefully I can put these things right now.
Right. Here's to 5 goals in 5 games.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
Tea for two. Claire Tomlinson and Noel Whelan. And who ate all those buns? There was more there when they started that piece, wasn't there? Now then, £2 million, that was all. At the time, some felt it was an expensive £2 million, but right now, it's a very good £2 million, isn't it?
Yeah, obviously when Middlesbrough signed Noel Whelan, we'd heard all about the little headlines that's showing you in the caption there, his reputation, but never had one moment's bother with him from the day he came. He always worked extremely hard in training and worked hard in games. He's obviously been a little bit unfortunate, or a big bit unfortunate, with injuries over the last couple of seasons, but he's in the team now, he's fit and he's well and he's confident and he has got ability. But I mean, you know only too well, Richard, with Coventry City, hasn't quite fulfilled, he's admitted it himself, he hasn't quite fulfilled the potential shown in his early years, but he's a young lad and he's still got time.
What type of front runner is he?
Well, it's hard to say about partnerships for a start, because, I mean, Middlesbrough had so many different partnerships this season, it's, I think, about 10, a dozen different partnerships this season. He's not the quickest. Noel is not the quickest. He's energetic. He's a decent finisher, as shown him scoring a few goals lately. He just likes to put defenders under pressure. Mm. I mean, he's really hard working. He's not one of these that shield the ball a lot and bring other people into the game. He tries to get down the sides. He basically makes a nuisance of himself and tries to get into goal scoring positions and works extremely hard, which is obviously so important nowadays.
It's good to see him first choice in the minute, isn't it?
Smash
you it. Talked about Graham Stuart. You said he's one of those that every club needs. Does Phil Stamp come into that category?
Well, Phil, we're just he's a big lad, Phil. He's like Chubby Brown in a Boro strip, Stamp. You know, he's a big lad. But
maybe he ate those buns.
I think Stampy ate a few more buns than that. But he's a player, he just stacks the talent. I mean, he's got so much going for him. He's big, but he's got great stamina, and he's got terrific pace. He's a game lad as well. He's a good header of the ball. He'll score you goals. I mean, he's got so many attributes, but he's just had an absolute nightmare over the last, I don't know how many appearances he's made for Middlesbrough, but he's been at the club a long while, and it's not many. And if he can get on an injury-free run, I mean, we've been saying that.
Why does he keep picking up injuries then?
I think it's maybe one or two problems with his ankles. It's hard to say, he's just one of these injury-prone type players, but if they can get him fit well playing on a regular basis, I'm telling you, he's a real asset to Middlesbrough.
151 games.
151.
You didn't think I knew that, did you?
Well, it's not a lot. How long has he been here? I mean, he was here before Brian and all the rest of us joined Middlesbrough, so he's been here 8 or 9 years.
Ten.
Ten, is it? Thank you.
Anything else?
Well, let's swap seats, Richard.
Boro have won 8 and lost 2 of the last 14. Charlton's 2 wins have both come in the last 6 matches. Boro unbeaten in the last 6 at home, and they've won 5 of those. Charlton's last win in this part of the world against Middlesbrough all the way back in 1990 when Lenny Lawrence's Charlton won by 2-1. Rob Lee was amongst the goal scorers. Join our match commentators Andy Gray and Martin Tyler.
And Alan Kirbishley played in that match for Charlton as well, so maybe he'll be looking into the memory bank to get the right sort of result today. No, Whelan, we had a look at him. We were there that Youth Cup night, weren't we, all those years ago, and he was a top draw, really, as a youngster.
I think Noel's right when he says that he's disappointed in what he's not achieved. I thought that night we looked around at the Beckhams, the Butts, the Scholes and Evils. We all thought these lads can go on. But when you looked at Leeds, we definitely, I think you and I and everyone there, thought Noel Whelan would be in amongst them with the amount of success that he could achieve. He hasn't done that. For various reasons, as he's quite openly admitted and honestly admitted, Martin. But I think here now, under the regime that he's working here now, there's still time for Noel to achieve plenty in the game. And I think what I've noticed more than anything, his fitness levels seem to be better than they've been for a long time. And I think that's important for somebody like Noel Whelan.
And he is the only member of that Leeds Youth team of 9 years ago still playing in the Premiership.
Well, there is a plus.
Yeah. Right, let's look at the teams for you. And Steve McLaren has decided to stay with the 11 who completed Middlesbrough's Premiership double over Sunderland on Tuesday, so he's kept faith with Gianluca Festa despite the Italian defender's distasteful sending off at the Stadium of Light. And the unchanged side also means Phil Stamp keeps his place after starting his first game of the season. Schwarzer, Echiog and Boksic, notable names on Middlesbrough's injury list. Charlton's problems on that front are easing, and Mark Fish is back in the side today after an illness, replacing Paul Konchesky. 2 December signings, when Alan Kirbishley was dramatically short of senior players, have emphasised the manager's shrewdness in the transfer market. George Costa at the back, and Tuesday's match winner against Derby County, the midfield player Chris Bart-Williams.
Well, I think what we're going to see is like for like, Mark. When you and I started watching the Manchester United Cup tie, it was 4-4-2 for Middlesbrough. Not today. That formation that did so well second half against Manchester United, it was a back three of Gavin, Southgate and Festa, and Gianluca Festa.
They'd like to have 2 Southgates.
They would like 2 Southgates, but they're going to see a back three of those three who did ever so well in the second half, then did ever so well again till Festa got sent off, obviously, against Sunderland. But and it's these areas where I just wonder, we're going to see sort of individual battles on these right and the right and left side, and with Stockdale and Queudrue, I think it's important when you play at home that those two are playing a lot of their game going that way. They don't want to be getting, I think whoever wins these battles here, if Stockdale gets pushed back too far going that way, Martin, they want him to be working up that way, same with Queudrue, working his way forward and not spending too much of his time at making it a back five. And that's what they're going to try and do, I think, with those two in there. Midfield's going to be a key area as well, and there's experience and quality in both of them. We've already talked in the studio about Phil Stamp back in the side, hasn't played much this season.
And he's keeping Robbie Mustoe out, so that's a compliment to Stamp.
Very much so. Ince back, didn't play against Manchester United, but back against Sunderland and back there. I think Paul does go forward, but I think out the three of them, and we put Greening in there as well, then Paul might be the one who shows a little bit more discipline than the other two. Let the other two get forward, use their energy, use their younger legs to affect the front. And then Dean Windass, who hasn't got a goal this year, I don't think, has he?
No.
And the one who is scoring goals, Noel Whelan. Now, these are both mobile strikers, I would call them. They won't just stand up there and be marked, Martin. They'll move around the pitch, got bags of energy between them. And we'll just wait and see about goals. You can't always predict them. You look on the face of it and you don't think there are many goals in these teams. And it might be a tight game. As Claire said earlier, the back three of Fish, Costa and Fortune is a nightmare, isn't it?
It's so, one we'll never forget.
No, you'll never forget it. And of course, there's made a few individual errors, I think, in recent games. And it's important that they don't make errors. They haven't conceded many. We only have 11 goals conceded away from the Valley. So that's a good record to have. And the wing-backs, this is what I mean about Robinson and Powell. Now, these are two very attacking-minded wing-backs. So I think that's a key area today. Stuart will get forward. We've seen that. I think Bart-Williams might do the Ince job and sit, and that's allowed Scott Parker to get forward with Graham Stewart as well, man. So you can see how balanced the teams are and how each individual battle might be a key one. up front, I think they've got two guys that can score goals, and that might be the difference in the match. Jonathan Johansson, oh, again, putting two of them in. Jason Euell won't thank me for that. But I think Johansson and Euell are two excellent finishers. Give them a chance, and Boro might pay for it.
Well, it is customary at this time to talk about the importance of the Premiership points at stake. And a glance at the league table shows in particular Middlesbrough's need. But all that has been put into perspective by the tragic loss suffered by Colin and Julie Cooper and their family. The sense of shock felt throughout football in this country, but most of all amongst Colin's Middlesbrough's colleagues. But the game goes on amid a deep sense of grief here on Teesside. It's Middlesbrough against Charlton. It's live.
Fan Zone fans this afternoon. Sky Digital viewer Stuart Barker is representing Middlesbrough and Steve Bridge is our Charlton fan. That's for Sky Digital viewers on Sky Sports Extra this afternoon, channel 404. And just a reminder, Sky Play is available now on Sky Sports 1. Simply press the red button on your remote control. Let's join our match commentators, Andy Gray and Martin Tyler.
Well, the Cooper family in all our thoughts and prayers. And a period of silence has been impeccably observed here. Well, in such somber circumstances, Noel Whelan's winner for Middlesbrough and the Middlesbrough performance at Sunderland, a marvellous achievement in midweek. And the same night, Chris Bart-Williams' first Charlton goal, really crucial for the London club to defeat Derby at the Valley. And Chris Bart-Williams is the first subject of the player cam here at the Riverside today for Sky Digital viewers in channel 404. Still plenty of gusting wind around the northeast, but it's a nice enclosed stadium this, and one hopes down at pitch level there won't be too much disturbance to the flow of the game.
I don't think there will be, Martin. You look around at the corner flags, they're all quite still. Not much action there, so let's hope the wind doesn't affect it.
Middlesbrough to kick off. In football terms, 2002 has been good for them. 7 Premiership points from 4 games, only 4 goals in those matches. But they've been productive ones, and they are through to the fifth round of the FA Cup with the scalp of Manchester United hanging from their belts. And a home tie to come as well against Blackburn, who incidentally knocked them out of the Worthington Cup earlier this season. Here's Gareth Southgate. And he's dropped one over the top. There's no flag for offside. But it was just too strong for the pursuing Dean Windass.
I told you they had willing runners up here up front. Look at the two boys. It's certainly a good decision from the linesman, but both players looking to get in behind. They've got bags of energy. They're very willing, the two front men of Middlesbrough. But I think so do the other two up the other end. I think Euell and Johansson are very like that. So the trio of centre-backs on each side will have to be alive and alert.
Southgate, one of those from Middlesbrough, the centre of the three, going in for a challenge. He didn't win cleanly. And Johansson almost forcing a way through. Out comes Mark Crossley at the sprint. As was Johansson in his pursuit of his aim and early goal for Charlton.
Well, he just does enough. Gareth Southgate, you can see he's not wanting to play the ball, but goes across the run of Johansson. He just did enough.
Charlton have had some iffy results recently, including their embarrassing FA Cup exit to Walsall, but they've won 3 of their last 5 in the league. And 3 more wins from their final 14 games should guarantee survival in the Premiership. One or two difficult games coming up, so I'd love to take something back to the southeast in the next 90 minutes here. Ince looking for Whelan. Kiely not trusting that would be seen as just an inadvertent touch from Powell. It might have been. It wasn't the most conclusive back pass, but the goalkeeper taking no risk. Mark Fish, healthy again after a stomach bug. Euell. Plenty of early action for Southgate. Windass barreling in to George Costa. Two sturdy individuals there. Robinson has got the right wing back role for Charlton. Luke Young still not fully recovered from being shaken up by J. Lloyd Samuel at the Valley recently. That Monday night match against Aston Villa. Parker. Graham Stuart trying to make some space for himself and trying to deliver early for Euell and Johansson, but only found Southgate. Robbie Stockdale. Now Ince. Those individual battles that Andy was talking about starting to take shape.
I think what both teams are doing early on as well, they are trying to get the ball forward to the front two as early as they can. A little mix up there. Stockdale a little anxious to get past Whelan.
We've got two of the country's brightest young managers here. Alan Kirbishley's name invariably in the frame when other jobs come up, currently Aston Villa, of course. And it's been something of a baptism of fire for Steve McLaren here at Middlesbrough, but he's had a lot of sorting out to do, reducing the average age of the side and the squad. It's something that's coming along well. And they certainly have picked up after that disastrous start. Remember, they lost their first four Premiership games of the season. Really gave the others a four-game start.
Nick at the back here, but that was nice build-up play. Jonathan Greening making the run off Dean Windass, but really well tracked by Chris Bart-Williams.
Paul Ince having a good look at the distance and what sort of barrier that Charlton have put up. Scott Parker's actually tried to come and assist the wall, getting it right. It is a long way out.
Put their own wall in front of it, almost middle for him.
Good stamp. And fires it into the line of players, foe and friend. Southgate. It was misjudged by George Costa. And the ricocheting in the end, suiting Charlton. Parker. Stuart can't rein it in.
It was half a chance of a break there, wasn't it?
Robinson. It's behind Southgate, and Euell has eased him out of the way, and those sort of decisions invariably do go against the forward. Mike Riley is the referee.
Oh, so an interesting one to look at. Did he kick the ground? Did he get caught? You see the right foot? Well, it was only a minute amount of contact there. He seemed to just catch his foot in the ground. Gareth Southgate.
Queudrue's pass at some distance there. He got through.
Well, I've tried to do that a couple of times, Middlesbrough, whether they're trying to say, well, let's early on, if we can get the ball forward, play in the other half.
Kept in by Greening. Whelan. Queudrue. Bend away from Middlesbrough's best intentions, really, towards Kiely.
He's just picking himself up, just getting involved in a little tangle of legs.
Touch on by Euell, recovering by Gareth Southgate.
Experience there. As a centre-back on the cover, you should never assume that your centre-back partner's going to win the header. Gareth Southgate didn't.
England squad, I imagine Holland will be announced next Saturday. This bar might have a chance of being in it, of course, with Ashley Cole being injured yesterday. And it's Powell having a look at the prospects from the throw. Stuart bombing and weaving, trying to help him out. Not the only one doing that, so it's going longer towards Johansson, too high for him. Mason Gavin got to it, then Gareth Southgate. Robinson. This is Bart-Williams. And again, Johansson trying to tee up Stuart. There's a stamp who knocked it away in Middlesbrough's moment of need. Euell. Johansson goes towards the near post, the ball will go towards the corner flag, it's the Charlton corner.
A little uneasy with their defending there, Middlesbrough. Well, they've scraped it away.
Jonathan Fortune. Well, the ball has gone up, but in the end, Fish, who flicked it goalwards, punched away by Crossley.
Kept the ball, though, keeping possession, keeping the pressure on.
A problem for Gavin here.
Well, his Fish went near close to the head of the man. I don't think he quite got it. It seemed to come off his shoulder. It was a decent little opportunity to help the ball in.
Jason Gavin, who started the game at Charlton but hasn't been seen too much since then in October. Well, Crossley's having a good run in the side with Mark Schwarzer out with a hernia operation. Close to returning, so there's good competition for that position for Steve McLaren. A 19-year-old goalkeeper on the bench, Bradley Jones. Marlon Beresford's moved to Burnley on loan.
I wonder if they'd get it back, because that looked like a misplaced pass from Chris Pill to me.
And Kiely sees the funny side of it, and the way he can take goal kicks, it's not going to hurt Charlton too much.
I think Charlton, Alan Curbis will be quite happy if the game stays a bit flat, Martin, and really doesn't pick up any tempo pace. They are away from home. They know Middlesbrough are on probably one of the better runs of the season so far.
Johansson taken from him by Parker. Oh, and hesitation there that could have been very damaging to Middlesbrough. Gavin maybe still just feeling, getting his feet back again after the injury.
Well, I think he was thinking about passing it back. In fact, he was, and he just changed his mind. I think you get a little bit close like that, it gives players a problem.
So Charlton have another corner. And this time it's Costa who went to the near post.
Well, that's twice they've stuck a ball in there, just about level with the near post, or just in front of it. And twice they've won it, but really haven't put in good enough headers. Costa first time, of Costa that time, Fish the first.
Charlton's away record is excellent. Just three defeats. Narrowly 1-0 at Villa and Southampton, but more recently a much bigger beating at Blackburn. And you might have heard Alan Kirby say, if we play like that today, we'll get nothing. I think that's been drummed into the players in the away dressing room here at the Riverside before they came out.
One game, they've obviously defended pretty well away from home, and only conceded 11. That's pretty good.
And it's kept it in, forcing Robinson to clear, back by Queudrue. Stamp using his physique to try and roll away from the opposition, but in doing so, he caught the eye of the referee. Thank you. Johansson. Gavin at his back, certainly Jonathan Johansson asked a question of the referee about a push. Will Charlton get his a throw? Stuart. Euell. Bart-Williams playing at the highest level with Sheffield Wednesday and Nottingham Forest. And having come on loan, he's now on a contract with Charlton to the end of the season. He's severed his ties at the City Ground. Greening. Not been easy for Jonathan Greening. He moved away from Manchester United, came here with Steve McLaren. He's played in all the Premiership games, but player of his creative ability would like to be in a side that's probably getting more on the ball, getting better results. I'm sure there's much more to come from him.
When you look at the Middlesbrough side, man, you can see how lacking in goals it is. I think only Noel Whelan, the only player that they've got on the pitch that scored more than one Premiership goal this season. That's been a major problem for Steve McLaren. Decent at the back, short but up, look tight, nice and tight and organised at times, but just can't get the balance right between good defending and being able to score goals at the other end at the moment. I don't think it's helped that Boxic's been in and out of the side all season.
Yes, there was some hope for Middlesbrough that he would be amongst the substitutes today, but that hasn't materialised. Greening. Here's Whelan. Stamp, who had made the initial forward run from midfield.
He ain't getting that one, though.
Gordon McQueen, our studio guest, is a great champion of Robbie Stockdale when he had him, helped him through the junior levels of the club, but he didn't play at all in Middlesbrough's first team last season. He's getting a run now. As I say, the average age coming down.
I think it had
Fleming
to.
And Vickers have moved on. In the opening minutes here, Jason Gavin.
Again, it's another one of those challenges, Mark, that happened in the game, and I'm glad to see the referee has got that one right. Both players jumping, arms go up, you have to use them as leverage. It was no more than an accidental clash. Part and parcel of the job if you're a centre-back.
These features do tend to get rearranged. Conference, I can thoroughly recommend the football in that league. Stevenage against Dagenham and Redbridge, that's Monday at 7:30, Sky Sports 1. And on Wednesday, Andy and I will be at Upton Park with Richard as well for the FA Cup fourth round replay. West Ham against Chelsea, a home tie for the winners in round 5 as well. Sky Sports 2 and Sky Sports Extra, plenty to play for in that one. Paul Ince will be under the gaze of the player cam for Sky Digital Viewers, Channel 404, the Middlesbrough skipper. Jason Gavin's taken that pretty much in his stride, and here come Middlesbrough again with Ince. He loses out to Stuart Robinson. That's a wayward one. And Gavin, maybe he's still a little bit shaken up. He didn't want to play the ball long, maybe he didn't see any options, so he was quite pleased to get rid of it to Stamp. But when Stamp gave the ball back to him a moment later, he looked a little unsettled. But here's Greening. And Parker for company. Queudrue.
More red.
And Chris Bart-Williams. Noel Whelan, who started very young, he actually made his league debut with Leighton Orient as a 16-year-old. Queudrue with the throw, now protesting run. Charlton had to concede the corner. Do feel this will be a match of fine margins, and maybe a successful set piece will make all the difference.
Yeah, all it takes is a lack of concentration by the defending side.
Ince to take the corner. Southgate just coming out from the goal line, Whelan at the back post.
Oh, that was a strange one. Fortune, I think, got ahead of the ball for some reason. Marty, he gets ahead of this. I think whether the flight of the ball deceives him, he always knocks it back towards his own goal. Very fortunate. I mean, that could have just dropped anywhere.
Yeah, he hit Queudrue, I think. And the goal kick is the correct decision, despite the appeals for the corner. Even the willing Windass had no chance of chasing that one. There's the Frenchman Queudrue, who was with the Lens, played in the UEFA Cup semi-final against Arsenal a couple of years ago for Lens. Johansson. And Stuart getting ahead of Robinson. Back for John Robinson again. Good tackle by Queudrue.
2 feet is the signal from the referees. Right in that respect, Chris Bart-Williams does go in with 2 feet, showing for the ball, but very low and very much for the ball. You see as he comes in. So, although not a dangerous tackle in that way, referee is right to say, hey, it's 2 feet.
You can't help wondering, though, if that sort of thing had been done in all innocence, really, by an Arsenal player, then it might have all kicked off. I guess reputations don't happen by chance. It's certainly a talking point in the game at the moment. Bart-Williams. Johansson was trying to get there. Festa was fouled. Free kick to Middlesbrough.
I'm just thinking for 20 minutes that Alan Kirkwish would be fairly pleased with the way his team have started. Nice and bright. Their pass has been better of the two teams. Just got a feeling that Middlesbrough might just be settling, might just be edging their way into this.
Charlton pulled everyone back. I think Kiely has just set up a two-man wall. Slips the ball over that two-man wall and over Southgate as well. Just felt a little flick then, might have given Charlton some problems.
I just think it's a bit straight, Martin. They've got a nice angle there, you know, to deliver a ball, pack the other side, deliver a ball, go and attack it. I just thought that was a little straight. It really would have taken a supremely accurate pass and a fantastic header with back to goal. And it's obviously a training ground, one they work on.
It's not been much fun on the training ground over the past few days with the weather. The training grounds tend to be open. Southgate. Jason. The ball collected here by Windass. The tank came out. Charlton's tank, George Costa.
A little unlucky. And there's absolutely nothing he can do coming out like that but get across Windass. And as Windass just pokes the ball past him, there was always going to be contact. I think a free kick's probably right. Obstruction as much as it, but oh, I'm really surprised at this. I find that extraordinary, Martin. It's a nothing challenge, it's absolutely ridiculous.
As I mentioned, Arsenal a few moments ago, Mike Riley was the referee for that FA Cup tie against Liverpool at Highbury last Sunday. And now he'll be hoping that the red card that he produced 3 times then will be not on display today.
Did it at Bolton as well, did it?
Three red cards in it, yeah. Yep. Bolton, Leicester.
This is a better chance, just about the right distance.
Queudrue's already shown us what a good right foot he is. Windass in, either of them capable.
It's Windass into the wall. That is my Stockdale. Goalkeeper ball. Middlesbrough, we shouldn't forget, had a horrible time at home last season. And Terry Venables did a tremendous job to keep them up, given that home record. They only won four of their 19 home games. They've actually won four already under Steve McLaren this season. So if they can make it five today, that would be a landmark. Another step towards their survival. Powell, but no breakthrough as yet by either side. Bart-Williams. Now Parker. Euell. Johansson.
And the advantage of the extra defender in there, he did brilliantly to hold off Southgate.
Flash here with Fish and Whelan.
Well, the big lads, you can test it. You see the clash. Again, going for the ball.
Eyes very much on the ball from both players.
Yeah.
It's good to see Noel Whelan playing up front again. Even before his goals, he'd been used, I think, at all his clubs. Leeds Coventry and Middlesbrough as an outsided midfield player from time to time. So he can help his goal tally. Started out as an England youth international as a striker and in very good company, a very talented group of players of his age group. The champions of Europe. Gavin. Fortune for Charlton. They've got very high hopes of him. They've given him a new long-term contract. Euell. Bart-Williams picked it forward under pressure in the end. Queudrue. This is Greening. Get it over George Costa.
A lot of cancelling out going on out there, Mark. I'm talking to him, but matching up like for like formation wise, and that's what's happening.
Queudrue got past Bart-Williams, Ince being encouraged to have a crack. He didn't need any second bidding. And the Euell forward for Charlton at the moment. Cleverly outmanoeuvred by Southgate. He carries the fight to Charlton. Stockdale's cross. Oh, and Whelan's free! But he was always reaching for it, even though he gave it the full dive.
No, that was better. Best move of the match, that. Gareth Southgate at the heart of it when he intercepted pass and brings it forward, steps into midfield and keeps his run going. That's important, but not great marking in the back post. I know Robinson not used to being there. He's trying to call one of his centre-backs, but if he sees it, he's got to go in, Martin, if he's near his player. He didn't. Unfortunately for him, the ball just drifted away from Noel Whelan, I think.
Johansson, not for long. Checking back because Greening has made another forward run. Parker trying to keep tabs on him again as Middlesbrough decide who's going to take the throw.
It's just hard for either team to find any amount of space. The three midfield players are in against each other man for man, the wing backs are man for man. Somebody's got to do something a little special to create a little bit of space.
Euell. We'll try and get some support up with him here. Including Parker. And it deflects away for a corner for Charlton.
certainly got plenty of options, Charlton, when you look at the corners, Mark, when you look at the three centre-backs, both Euell and Johansson are pretty good near as well, so they've got five pretty decent targets in there.
And Bart-Williams, a capable player, delivering the set pieces. Just looking again near post towards the Fish this time.
Fish did all right there because I think that was a little short, that ball.
Similar starting position for the South African again. And flick from Fish. Windass clears and there was no one out there for Middlesbrough. They can push out as a group. Put back by Powell. Fortune guides it down well. Johansson. Robinson. Bart-Williams. Nottingham Forest connection there. Bart-Williams and Crossley.
Lovely strike, but how easy does it make this look? This is hit with a fair bit of venom in it, but Mark Crossley just plucking apples there. So used to seeing the foreign goalkeepers just help those kind of shots over the bar or punch them out.
I was going to say, sometimes they use the pace on the on the ball to parry it back outside the penalty area. Conventional catch from Crossley, a good one. Well hit by Chris Bart-Williams.
Looking at this match, everyone's predicting goals, Martin. I think when you look at the trouble that both teams are having, Middlesbrough at home, where only 13 goals in their home games and 13 away goals for Charlton. I don't think anyone's expecting a 4-4.
You're expecting a 4-4 from Charlton against West Ham.
No, it was not. We were debating the same things that night. Lack of goals from both teams.
You never know. Joy of watching your football live. And, especially when Costa and Fish go for the same ball, and it could have been a costly mistake for Charlton. Actually wanted a touch from Southgate. Just one goal in the last three meetings between these two clubs, and the man who scored it is here today, but only on the Charlton bench, Matt Svensson. That was in last season's fixture at the Valley. 0-0 there in October of this season, and here last March. Get him on.
Are you just trying to add more stats as to why this will be tight? Maybe only one goal in it then.
No goals in the opening half now, that's a fact. Let's hope that that changes in the hour we've still got to go. And no shortage of effort on that front. The stakes are still high for both these clubs, although certainly you feel they're just slightly more relaxed after excellent midweek results. Newell, one of those keeping Matt Svensson out of the starting 11 for Charlton, as the subject for player cam. He's their top scorer with 9 goals this season. The Sky Digital viewers, channel 404, if you've got the interactive buttons.
Well, Charlton, making life difficult, setting the stall out.
Hopeful one from Queudrue. Turned away by Fortune, good hold up play by Euell, Bart-Williams. Now Powell and Stuart. Hansen's gone to the left. There's some waiting on the touchline down beneath us for a switch of play, but it's Parker who to take on Middlesbrough. Just let it get away. And an ambustious piece of play by Whelan.
Now, this is good play from a defender who steps across. No, Whelan just invites him to say, go on if you want to knock me over. I'll get my body in front.
get my free kick. Euell. That's the time of joining from midfield again, further forward. And I believe that a bit of space for Greening. Something unattended at the moment as Bart-Williams went with the Windass and fouled him. Here is Greening. Good defensive strength by Fish.
That's what hasn't quite happened for Middlesbrough in the first half. That central area with Stamp, Ince and Greening haven't quite got enough for the ball, haven't quite been able to influence the game. I think the other three, Stuart, Bart, Williams and Parker, have looked a little brighter, a little bit more inventive.
Paul Konchesky is getting ready for Charlton.
Well, we think there's a problem with Mark Fish.
Konchesky, unlucky in the manager's words, to be left out. That was the one change from the side that started the win against Derby. And it was Mark Fish who came back. Fish's illness rather than an injury, so it is Mark Fish to go off. We'll try and get an update on the reason why. Sure, generally, Festa will remind his P's and Q's today. He's apologised to his teammates for that episode with Kevin Phillips on Tuesday, but here's Paul Konchesky. And it is Fish that he will replace.
That's a blow. As I said, I think they've defended well as the three at the moment, Mark. There's been no real dramas at the back. They've been comfortable. Whether that means a change in system, we'll wait and see as well.
Well, Konchesky can play in the back three, and it'll mean fortune being in Fish's position. And
it looks like they're going to stick with
Konchesky
it,
across with Costa. That's as it was, I think, on Tuesday. Whelan. Here's Ince. Let's hear about that injury from Claire Tomlinson. Claire.
Well, Martin, Mark Fish actually signalled to the bench that he couldn't carry on. It's a knee injury for him. Konchesky taking his place.
One man's misfortune is another man's gain. Paul Konchesky. Mark Fish looking very fed up with life.
Frustrated, I think, so well, isn't it? Mm.
Ince with the corner. Not by Stuart, though, at the near post. Got Robinson to work with here. But no one else. And didn't like where Robinson had run away to, he couldn't find him.
I don't think I liked the fact that he didn't give a shout either, that Paul Ince was really making tracks back. Bit of frustrating half for the home side. Difficult times for them, obviously. And that little feeling, it's a little flat around the place. And I think that's reflected on the pitch as well.
Fortune finding Windass unflinchingly in the way of his clearance. He just got himself back in the team, Dean Windass. And he hasn't got a senior goal this season, but he was telling me before the game about all the ones he's got in the reserves.
He would be.
Robinson. John Robinson's cross. In the right place, Gareth Southgate for Middlesbrough. Konchesky coming on to this one. Powell. He was played into trouble, the Charlton substitute. fine competitive joust for the ball there with Stubb. That has been a feature of the contest.
The worst ball played over the back there, asking. Jason Gavin, with a little question.
Colin Kirby worked his strikers very hard on Friday morning on their finishing. Hasn't really been an opportunity to show whether that has brought sharpness into the match itself.
I think that's been the case for both sides.
Good link up here between Middlesbrough's two up top, Windass and Whelan. Well, it was a good link up to start with.
I do think if you're Steve McLaren and you're in the position that you're in, you do want to keep games tight as long as possible. 0-0 suits him. He knows that his team aren't full of goals, and it's important that they don't let their opponent score. So although I think Steve would have liked to have seen his team create a few more chances, I don't think he'd be too disturbed. I'd like to see a bit more tempo in the game, I think.
When did those two goals come against Manchester United in the Cup? Very late.
That's what I mean, as long as you keep the game, Manchester United could easily put the game out of sight. Well, you know, for 60 minutes, they didn't. And they got their chance. And I think that's the nature of the way that that Steve has got to at least get them playing at the moment.
John Robertson at least attacked that Mark Crossley clearance, unlike Laurent Blanc and that fateful moment in that FA Cup tie. You mentioned the 4-4 game earlier. Jonathan Johansson got two in that game, two of the Charlton four, but he hasn't scored since. Indeed, he hasn't scored an away goal this season. We've got two strikers on the bench. Charlton, we mentioned Matt Svensson, but Kevin Lisbie is there. Well, he scored the winner at Chelsea, the winner at Ipswich. Here's Stuart. Queudrue. He can't take that edge of anxiety away from the crowd. Put up by Bart-Williams, Ince wasn't complaining, nor was the referee.
That would have been a free kick in any other country in Europe, but here.
Probably in the world. Powell. Euell trying to make something for himself. He's got others. Charlton quite well represented in that attack. They had four forward, and here's Konchesky. Visiting team trying to make a breakthrough before half-time. Bart-Williams. Stuart.
A bit of help. There's not a lot of movement going on around Graham Stuart there. He was dead ever so well. He bided his time.
Euell. A shame, because Powell played him into a position where he might have got behind Middlesbrough, and I think he knows it.
But they've looked more likely, Charlton, haven't they? You know, they've been brighter. They've asked Middlesbrough's back three and back five at times more questions than have been asked at the other end.
Konchesky. Euell again, Powell, Bart-Williams, defending by Southgate, but it drops for Euell. First time cross from Chris Powell. Greening heads it away, only to Stuart, can't keep it down, and so angry with himself for that.
Yeah, John Roberts is just saying why, and you could hear him out there. I have to have a go, and he does, having controlled it instantly, and it sat up beautifully. He's got to have it. He's got to take the shot on.
One or two stoppages in this first half for Middlesbrough injuries. Robbie Stockdale just doing some flexing and stretching there. Not needing the physio Bob Ward at the moment. 3 minutes plus added time for those injuries to half-time. Konchesky. knocks it forward early for Windass, but it's maybe the wind in the ground that's taken the ball away from him. Looked as it was delivered that the pass might carry real potential. Queudrue comes off Parker. Parker's header. Still got the snarl.
A little unlucky. You know, sometimes players don't jump, and I think that's what happens here. I don't think Jason Euell's going off the ground at all, Martin, does he? But Ince is. Now, that, I don't think that's a free kick. I think Paul's entitled to go for it. Jason Euell wants to keep feet on the ground.
Bart-Williams thought he might just get there ahead of Ince, but the ball beat both of them. Parker. Parker again. Robinson. Tough by Bart-Williams. Fortune. Looking to defeat Charlton. Bart-Williams again. Bump in the back of John Robinson.
That free kick, this isn't it? It's one of those stupid ones where Robinson's not going anywhere, right against the touchline. Why don't you just hold him up? Now you've got to defend a free kick just before half time. They can load them in there if they want.
Konchesky taking it. Very nearly reached. By Johansson.
Well, I'm assuming this is meant. There's a big gap there. He's not that far away, Jonathan Johansson.
Queudrue. Whelan.
It's been that 10.5 from Middlesbrough. Frustrating. So one more good use.
Two extra minutes. Euell. Oh, and it's Parker, but he won't get there. Pass not quite powerful enough to get the ball away from Gavin for Charlton. Robinson.
Awesome move. Awesome move.
Stuart. And it's a bit of a lunge by Stamp.
Well, although I think Charlton have been the better side, passed it better, moved it better, they still haven't looked like they've got enough to fashion a chance. I think Middlesbrough's back three have done pretty well at holding them, been pretty well protected. I think that's the one downside for Alan Kirbishley. I'd like to have seen a few more chances created.
Matt by Costa, the flag's gone up against Euell. Time. Free kick here for Middlesbrough.
Yeah, there's a little six of one, half a dozen of the other. But it's a chance. I wonder if Queudrue will be allowed to have a little look at this. He's walked on over lazily and almost nonchalantly. He's got the left foot for it. He's already struck a couple of glorious cross-field passes that suggest he can thump it. Will the skipper pull rank?
Nice. Queudrue! Well, it was the best effort of the first half. It's almost the last kick of the first half. Certainly the best save of the half as well.
I think he's happy this is straight above him, Martin. I think a couple of yards either side of Dean Kiely. And that would have really taken some saving. So he could thump it. It didn't disappoint.
Might Riley allowing the corner to be taken. Festa and Windass had a little powwow there around the penalty spot, but well, it ended the half on a high. The Frenchman came close, but it's been a very tight, probably as expected, first 45 minutes here at the Riverside, and it's Middlesbrough nil, Charlton Athletic nil.
And you echo the sentiments of the boys. That's how it was when Manchester United were here. And look what happened second half there. Favourites for the cup went out after a stirring second half from Middlesbrough. We'll put that into perspective when we come back with Gordon McQueen. At the Riverside yet, but I remember being here 3-4 weeks back. Exactly the same situation, Gordon, when Middlesbrough played against Manchester United in the FA Cup. Second half was very different. Can you see something like that happening here?
Well, I hope so, because, I mean, Middlesbrough at home, they've got to have a push for it. I mean, you get 3 points today and you're going to climb up that league a little bit more. Important for Alan Kirbishley as well, getting nearer to a possible European place. But I think both sides need to be a bit more positive. I mean, obviously, you can't fault the defenders. Defenders are doing their job. They're both playing the same system, back fives or back threes. I think probably Middlesbrough are pushing their wing-backs forward a little bit more, you know, with Queudrue and Stockdale, probably a little bit more higher up the pitch than what Charlton are. But it's been a no-fun zone in the first half. There's room for improvement in the second half, that's for sure. He can't change this. Well, he changed the system. He might tinker with it again. You look at young Marinelli on the bench or the pace of Andy Campbell on there. It's important for Steve McLaren to get the 3 points here, I think, today. And he might look at tinkering with the side today like he did at half-time against before they went on to beat Manchester United.
They made us wait until stoppage time for the first attempt, in truth. Can't remember the keeper making many other saves. But Andy was right, wasn't he? Either side, and that's a real test.
That looks as if it's going in the back of the net. I mean, unfortunately for Middlesbrough, any three kicks they have had have been from a fair old distance. That's quite a long way out, that, to be expecting a goal, but it's a great attempt. Ball's moving a little bit in there and Kiely just knocks it over for a corner. But it's the only real attempt in the game and the only real save any goalkeepers had to make.
No reason at all why Alan Kirbishley should change anything, because right now he must be very pleased with what his side have done. But if Middlesbrough want to win it, what else must they do? What must they start to do?
Be a little bit more positive. Runs from midfield, runs from the wing back. The central defenders, the centre forwards and Whelan and Windass, they've not had the best of halves. I know Whelan's been playing really, really well, full of confidence, scoring goals of late. They might look at changing it in the striking partnership that they've got out. Might look change things at half time, about, I think.
He must be fairly happy about his side defensively again. They don't give much away these days, Boro, do they?
No, they don't, and neither do Charlton. I mean, Charlton are very, very stingy away from home, and Middlesbrough are pretty mean as well. You know, it's something they've had all season. They've always had a reasonably solid look. I know they conceded a few goals earlier on in the year, but of late they've had a nice, solid look about the side. But that's not enough if you want to win games at home. They maybe need to be a little bit more positive, and as I say, maybe get... Stockdale didn't do too badly in the first. He knocked over one or two half-decent crosses. But get the wing-backs more involved. Maybe somebody for the middle of the park. Remember, they've got three in the middle of the park. You know, so you can get maybe Stamp or Greening or Ince going and supporting the strikers a little bit more. Because one of those three, I've got the licence to go forward in that system. And it's not really happened yet.
Let me cheer you up. He is going to change it. He's bringing Campbell on second half. And you're a big fan, aren't you? Stockdale is the player going off.
I'm surprised at Robbie Stockdale going off, because I thought he did as well as them. They're probably a little bit better than
Campbell will inject some pace, won't
he? Yeah, well, he certainly get that. I mean, when you're talking, in all seriousness, when you're talking about Owen and Henry and Craig Bellamy, this kid has got that type of pace. Obviously, his all round game, he's not a great finisher, Andy, and he's not particularly great at holding the ball up. But you knock the ball in behind the Charlton defenders and he will frighten the life out of them.
A scorer, of course, against Manchester United. Mighty B here. No goals yet. It's Middlesbrough nil, Charlton nil, but plenty to come. We're back on Wednesday night, live FA Cup football. The replay between West Ham and Chelsea, which of course has to finish on the night. It's a 7 o'clock start on Sky Sports 2. Well, it's Campbell for Stockdale here, a young man who has a squad number, who has a jersey these days, but that hasn't always been the case, Gordon, has it?
No, when he was making his first appearance at Liverpool a few years ago, very young lad at the time as well, and kit man forgot to put his strip in. I don't think the kit man's there anymore. We've got a good one now, Alex Smith, the cup manager here. Much more professional.
So what happened? You had to go and find him a jersey then, did
just,
you?
They just borrowed one off a supporter, and but it never worked. He never scored the goal, but hopefully he'll perk things up for Middlesbrough this half, because they need it. I mean, I think Marlon Kirbishley will be a lot happier with a point than what Steve McLaren will. And they are still in the, well, skipping round the relegation issue at Middlesbrough, there's no question about that. And I think if they go out here, step it up a bit, there's 3 points here for the taking today.
They need a second 45 like they had against Manchester United. Three, John Andy Gray and Martin Tyler.
Thanks, Richard. Andy Campbell, of course, scored against Manchester United the second clinching goal. It was his first Middlesbrough goal for 21 months. He's had a lot of injury problems. Around the injuries, he's been out on loan as well to the likes of Sheffield United and Bolton. Could he make the difference in the second half for the Borough? Robbie Stockdale, who was struggling just before half-time, has a hamstring problem.
Well, one thing we'll wait to see, Martin, as well, it mean a change of system. Maybe we'll let you know about that as soon as the game starts.
No one would expect Campbell to play up front. Certainly that's where he's lined up at the kickoff, which is Charlton's prerogative at the start of the second period.
Looks the three are at the back. You see Stamp making the header there. Phil Stamp playing on this right-hand side. Looks as a wing-back.
Certainly a job he has had before.
Windass just dropping deeper into midfield, allowing Campbell to play up front alongside Noel Whelan.
So, I remember looking for their first victory on this ground, their last win. Middlesbrough was at the old Ayrton Park Stadium.
Well, it wasn't the worst ball that I've seen played in from Chris Powell. Just about 7 yards out, middle of goal. Just lacking support play into the box.
John Fortune caught in possession by Campbell and then he fouled him. There's no flag. Hits the corner flag and it is a corner. Greening cut the ball in the first place. Still looking for his first Middlesbrough goal.
No, he just gets a little space, half a yard maybe. It's a free header for Gareth Southgate, but not the easiest, 12 yards out.
Still missing his old pal Hugo Ekiog. Southgate and Ekiog have done very well in their short time together at this club after many years together at Aston Villa. Euell. Ince. That's the sort of ball that might be tailored for Campbell's pace. He's trying to drive it to the feet of Windass. Stuart now picking out Johansson. Powell well forward again. Still Powell. Bounced away off Southgate to be collected by Stamp.
Just a little bit hurried with the pass from Stamp.
Out.
Here's Festa. Hasn't played much first-team football this season. Largely because of the good form of Southgate and Ekiog.
There's great improvisation there from Scott Parker. Greening had got in behind him, he stumbled, he was falling to the ground when the ball arrived. Did ever so well to head it back.
Just feel that one slip, one mistake could be the difference today between this just petering out into a draw and maybe one side celebrating what would be an important 3 points. We've got Manchester United to come next weekend at the Valley, and they go to Leeds. They've got a home game against Chelsea. Some big fixtures looming large for Alan Kirbishley's side. Parker. It was for half, I think, the game would be stopped as Whelan went down. Talked about the injuries he's picked up in his senior career. This style of play rather invites them. He certainly doesn't shirk the physical side of the game.
No, if you see, he just gets a knee in the backside there.
Gordon Strachan asked me yesterday at Highbury to pass on his best wishes to Noel Whelan and congratulations on his run. Of course, Gordon was Noel's landlord for a while. Stuart, and Johansson, and now Powell. Robinson was trying to come in off the right-hand side to pitch out another option. All that passing in front of the Middlesbrough back line, which stood firm.
Well, that's what's happening most of the game, Mark. It's been played in front of the back threes, the back fives, if you like. Very little has been played down the sides and behind them.
Crossley is a left-footed kicker, and there. Right foot there, fell the ball only powerfully upwards, not forwards. Johansson, Powell, now Konchesky. Plenty of that type of play to admire, closing down, taking the sting out of the opponent's attempt to make the first breakthrough. And pad off Campbell. Costa, so much experience of European football with Porto and over his country, Portugal, over 40 caps. Southgate, over 40 caps for England. Greening. Here's Whelan. That reflects his current confidence. Well, there haven't been many shots in the game, and Queudrue is certainly hit the best one of them in the first half.
Well, his left foot's better than his right, but Festa plays a ball here, Martin, and follows it. You see him right in the penalty spot there. Gianluca Festa got forward, almost gets on the end of that, but never in control of the shot. And that's what you feel Middlesbrough have got to do. Do something different. Put a player in where they don't expect him. That's what Festa tried to do there. Almost paid off for them.
Gavin up well, and here's Konchesky. Southgate again leading the play. He's the one who gives the depth to it. Gavin hasn't gone forward much. Festa, of course, came back dramatically into the team on New Year's Day and picked up a winning goal against Everton. Have to do the same here again, particularly to repay the players he felt he let down, even though they won the game, Middlesbrough at Sunderland. Now Powell, Stuart. Stuart again. It's a corner.
They went offside, I think. That's what Middlesbrough want, they're saying, is a push out. Not for this one, it's a lovely run in here. And they try and pick out the player. This is not the best struck shot, but as it comes back out and it's played forward there,
They're looking for the flag to go up. It doesn't go up. Linesman decides that they're coming back away from goal. So the flag stays down and corner given.
Corner again, entrusted by Charlton to Chris Bart-Williams. Parker. Robinson is getting the block in. Queudrue. Trying to show some adventure down the Middlesbrough left. Festa has to play it back. This is where you'd expect Crossley to kick it better.
Yeah, he kicked it further back in the stand. It's good left foot.
Almost 10 minutes gone in the second half. Still locked together at 0-0. Middlesbrough and Charlton. Johansson. Keep it in with some difficulty. Fortune.
The wind, I think, is picking up well. It's starting to have an effect at ground level. A lot of rubbish flying about the pitch, swirling about. So it doesn't make it any easier for the players to pass and control the ball.
Stuart. Johansson rules offside.
Yeah, we had a pretty good look at that. You and I almost dead in line with this. Easy one for us to call.
He's just a little lazy, isn't he, though? If he gets himself back that 2 yards, Jason Euell, then he's on.
And just, maybe away.
Yeah.
Great challenge on Greening.
Free kick.
It's hit across with pace. Sometimes they are very difficult to defend. Southgate has stayed back, allowing Festa to go forward. Out off John Robinson's head. Whelan. Campbell in the centre. Running slips. Clear to his strike partner Johansson. Still battling in midfield, Jason Euell, where of course he can play. You're right, Andy, the wind really has picked up. And, it's another dimension. The players are finding it difficult to get the better of each other. Now I've got to try and get the better of the conditions as well. See the debris blowing onto the pitch. Robinson. This is Johansson. Can't get his cross in. Bart-Williams. Plenty of good toil in midfield and technique as well, but no one's really been able to dominate the game, and that's when Charlton thought they might get into a dominating position. Mike Riley has pegged them back.
Well, Charlton players didn't think this was a free kick. They feel that Johansson slid in, won the ball, played it back. It's a close call, I think. That really could have gone either way.
Seems there was some communication between goalkeeper and defender. The defender was Konchesky. There's no one really around for Middlesbrough to make it absolutely critical that they got it right. Campbell taking it on with a brand. In the end, I think that's the decision that the referee's given.
Looked like he was going to allow it to go. Just dropped slightly behind him, you can see that, and he just reaches out. Not once, but twice.
He didn't spot the first one, he certainly spotted the second. Windass. Little flick with no one behind him. Konchesky played it in a hurry. There's been a lot of that this afternoon. Really been a day for measured play. Johansson, well, Bart-Williams had the ball. Maybe Charlton will be happy to get the free kick, give them the chance to load the centre-backs forward. Well, two of them have got. Konchesky stayed back. Bart-Williams to take it.
Too much. Very much like the free kick that gave Liverpool a lead at Elland Road earlier today, but a little bit further out.
Pedro.
That's the exuberance of youth, I think. I would say that there. Yeah.
Well, it wasn't a great touch. It wasn't the easiest ball to take, no. But it really got away from him.
And it's a. I don't think it was much nasty intent there, but he's just trying to retrieve the situation. He's a fraction late.
Well, if he survived that, Scott Parker will be followed by our cameraman with the player cam.
He popped up, okay. Just the young lad of booking, Andy Campbell.
I don't think the referee had any choice about that. Gavin. A little flick on from Stuart. Cross goes Fortune, who's the nephew of the Cardiff forward Leo Fortune West. Good footballing family. Looking for Andy Campbell of Middlesbrough, the second half substitute. Fortune's throw. By Queudrue. Gavin. Fortune. Straight to Festa though. He slipped. Recovers. Greening. Was booked in the first half. Andy, you and I have seen plenty of games in the Premiership that have started to open up in the last third after being as tight and tense as this one.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, that normally happens, Martin, at the Premiership level. You do find that teams are tight for an hour, 65 minutes. But this game hasn't really taken off at all, and no surprise to see that Steve McLaren's decided to make the second change. This one, I'm sure, not enforced, but this one, tactical.
Well, much of what we've seen so far has been professional, of course, but rather predictable. Enter the unpredictable. Carlos Marinelli, citing young talent from Argentina. Can Southgate sneak in here for Middlesbrough? His times in the cup tie against Manchester United. Cost him his place for a couple of games. Here's a chance to re-establish himself.
Well, I wondered where he'd play. Played wide against Manchester United. It looks like he's just gone into that central area, and Steve McLaren is going to keep the same shape.
Campbell.
Summed up the day, that, wasn't it? But that's the first time that a midfield player in the central area has got beyond their own midfield players. I mean, the Charlton midfield players, and Greening did that then. It's the first time anyone in red shirts got the other side of the midfield.
It would have been a good contest if he'd taken it on, Campbell, because Konchesky is also quick, and he was the one who'd gone across to try and cope with the run, but he didn't need to in the end. Campbell left the ball behind.
Now that's Greening through, and when he plays it past Costa, you think, just get it out your feet. But he's a little unlucky, it was slightly behind him.
Mike Riley just pointing out to Jonathan Johansson that there have been one or two free kicks given against him. And one more. I mean, the yellow card will be out. Konchesky, Parker, Marinelli with him, he plays that position, Marinelli, he's got to do his defending as well. That's Stuart, looking for Robinson, Stuart on the scene again. He gets his cross in, can Powell get there first? Phil Stamp, who showed that he could defend.
He needed to as well, didn't he? Because Powell just sensed that something might be happening.
Robinson, better spell for Charlton. Haven't quite in the second half captured what they had in the first, when in a half without too many goal mouth incidents, they looked the livelier side. They would have expected down on the Charlton bench an improvement from Middlesbrough in the second period.
Well, in truth, Mark, there hasn't been one, really. They still struggle to. The passing's been poor today, Middlesbrough. I just think the tempo of their game as well, it's been very one-paced at times. That's the best I can say about it. There hasn't been enough pace. I think that's maybe why he got Campbell on at half-time. He is very quick, Andy Campbell, but they haven't been able to use that pace. They haven't still been able to get the ball beyond the back three, over the top, to give him something to run onto.
This is Johansson. Bart-Williams. Charlton's throw. Parker. Stuart. Now Euell.
That was a lovely ball.
And it's well controlled by the Charlton striker, Stuart. He's a winger by nature, John Robinson, if they can get him forward in this right wing-back position.
But you can see how Charlton are using it better, even when they're passing and movement, it's been better than Middlesbrough.
It hasn't produced a lead with three quarters of the game played. Headed by Johansson. Parker. It's got Parker making a lot of ground here, a lot of ground, until he's just hit away from the edge of the penalty area, but he's still got the ball. This is Powell. Corner for Charlton.
Do you know, it just couldn't have opened up for him. I thought as he drove across the box there, it just opened up once on his left foot to hit it, Scott Parker, but he just took the extra touch on it. It was a lovely run.
sense this is a crucial spell for Middlesbrough. They had a little bit of initiative. And Charlton back on their game again. Had a good last 5 minutes, but that's a poor ball by Parker, who's been instrumental in their improvement.
Good pressure there, isn't it? Look at that. Really good pressure there.
Fortune. Ince. But he's lost it. Euell. And ends with Bart-Williams. A shot that took a deflection.
Again, worked it well. This is a really good spell for Charlton. Good pressure. But they contribute. Look at that. That's poor play from Middlesbrough again. Lose it now. Really dangerous area. I think Costa just keeps his run going. Gets involved again. Has a little look. Sees it. Bart-Williams is in support. It must have just flicked off someone. Looked as if it was straight up in the air. Manchester United dominate for long, long periods against Marathon, not put that domination into goals and pay for it dearly. And I think Alan Kirbersley will be thinking this has been a good spell for us. We're better side in the first half, but we haven't created enough chances. We haven't taken any.
Ince.
You just feel that Middlesbrough create a chance somewhere, Mark.
Stamped. This could be it. Very well played by Kiely. Hasn't had a lot to do.
I think that helped, he got to it just before it bounced.
Johansson. Parker. Charlton getting Kevin Lisbie warmed up. Parker, Euell. Johansson in the centre. Oh, and here's Powell. If he'd taken it towards the goal, at the very least, he would have had a shot from a promising position.
What a chance, Martin. What a chance. And he knows it. And he's not a player that gets phased, you know, Chris Powell, when he's forward. I'm really surprised at the poor quality of this touch. He just has to take the pace off the ball, and then he must surely be testing the goalkeeper. What a chance for Charlton.
And at the other end, a rather tentative header from George Costa, a bit of breakdown in communications. They were 2-on-1, Fortune and he, against Noel Whelan, but it's gone behind. A bit of a gift of a corner, this, for Steve McLaren's men.
Well, how often have we seen teams that should have taken the lead, and then the next 10 seconds, the ball's down the other end and they're conceding?
Get up! Stay, they are on a bit of a run, Middlesbrough, we shouldn't forget that. Outside the area.
Yeah, it's just outside. And it's Costa again.
Will it be Costley?
No, this is a real good position. Make sure you've got players going across the flight of this ball. It's coming out from a decent angle. An awful lot of players on the ball. I'm not so sure why you would want four players out there. We're debating where it's going, I think that's the thing. Talk to Marinelli, they're saying this is where we want it. You put it there and we'll get across it. That must be what the centre-backs are debating here.
Maybe Festa's acting as the interpreter. Southgate had his say.
Often what happens, Martin, is you start to jog from there, and then when they get to a certain area, they sprint in.
Marinelli puts it in. That was exactly what they were trying to come up with. Another change for Charlton. It's Jonathan Johansson. Gives way to Kevin Lisbie. As I mentioned in the first half, with a couple of very important away goals to his name, that winner at Ipswich first away game of the season, and then at Chelsea very late on.
Well, he's quick as well. He gives them a different problem at the back now.
Festa. Southgate. Goalkeeper there. Kiely might rightly got into a very good position, I must say, looking down the penalty area line then to make sure that Kiely put the brakes on in time. It came off for Festa, but wasn't a deliberate back pass, it was a miscontrol actually.
Well, the goalkeeper looked to a referee signaled very quickly, pick it up if you like.
Controls are not meant to have heavy criticism here, because it is a very gusty, blustery day. It's been that sort of weekend up and down the highways and byways of English football. Tough test of technique. Some days you've just got to get out there and scrap it out, and you scraps harder. Just be celebrating this evening. And Southgate!
Oh, Jason Euell, does he get anything on this, Mark? Southgate comes in, Euell's not quite on him. I wonder if he just gets a brush on it and it just puts Southgate off. If not, yeah, he just brushes his head and that might just have taken it off the path that it was on. Half a chance.
Yes, there's no room to adjust in Southgate's situation then. Once just changed course. Konchesky, strong. Robinson, would have got to Lisbie away. Drew, with very good composure. Excellent ability. See why he's been a fixture in the team, apart from missing one through suspension since he made his debut at Charlton. No handball by Bart-Williams, despite the appeals. Euell. Southgate at his back. Stuart supporting from midfield.
Unlucky.
Whelan. He's strongly challenged by Konchesky. Southgate. Trying to come up with a formula to break the stalemate here. We're in the last 15 minutes. Marinelli. It is Southgate. Well, he's doing his best.
Well, I'm sure that was bobbling all over the place as it arrived here. Not his strongest side, he's left either. But he started to play off, full marks to gather Southgate. Brought the ball forward, played it wide and followed his pass.
Long by Queudrue. Campbell chasing. George Costa stopping Whelan getting into another potential match-winning position. Gavin. Does seem, Andy, is that Steve McLaren has really settled on the system, hasn't he? That he wants to keep the three, hasn't been tempted to change that.
Not today, has he?
Maybe if he went a goal behind, that might trigger.
That might well do. But I think that he's very conscious of the fact of not losing the game more than anything, Mark.
Stuart. Okay. Never quite set the two in tandem there, the midfield players for Charlton. Marinelli.
What they've looked like today, Middlesbrough, has been a team with this system that aren't going to lose a game. They haven't really looked in that much danger of losing the football match, but on the other hand, they've never looked likely that they were going to be able to fashion something to win it. And I think that's maybe the problem Steve's had, is that fine act of knowing what's sufficient defensively so you don't take anything away at the opposite end of the pitch. The most important end is the creative end.
And have we got to a stage now where you might just take the wraps off one or two players and say, hang on, we've got 10 minutes to go, we haven't lost the game in the 78 minutes, let's go and win it now.
It depends how much the coach wants to win it. That's what I mean about balance. How much does he want to win it as opposed to maybe losing it if he takes that chance? And that's what managing is all about, really, at times. It's really big decisions, like now. Does he push a man forward? Does he take one out the back? Push one extra one into midfield?
And we shouldn't forget, although Steve McLaren's had a lot of plaudits, and rightly so, for his coaching, he's a relatively inexperienced manager making the decision, which is accountable. Lisbie. Got the shot beyond his opposite number, the other number 29, Jason Gavin, but not beyond Crossley, who's bowled it out well here to Marinelli. Greening joining Whelan and Campbell, and supporting Marinelli and getting on the ball. Here's Stapp.
Well, the one on the ball, Marinelli, is probably the one midfield player they've got out there who's got the individual ability to maybe create something.
Southgate playing it and supporting it again. He's actually gone on to a striking position as Stamp takes over and finds Gareth Southgate. Still Southgate, very untidy. But, the cross that no one was really attacking for Middlesbrough, and fortune swept it away. Into the last 10 minutes. Backing in again in an area where any doubt always goes in favour of the defenders. It's a reminder that there's live football for you on Monday, 7:30 from the conference. Stevenage against Dagenham and Redbridge, Sky Sports 1. And FA Cup football, the AXA-sponsored FA Cup. West Ham against Chelsea, fourth round replay, Sky Sports 2 and Sky Sports Extra. Join us on Wednesday at 7. Euell. Ince, Marinelli, lovely to keep Middlesbrough going and maybe flowing here, but Ince couldn't match the potential of his young colleague a moment or two earlier.
That's what you mean about Marinelli. He's the first Middlesbrough player in that area that's been able to do something like that, something different, something out of the ordinary.
He's stopped solidly there by Parker, and the two of them clashing when they were on the ground.
Well, there's a little tangle here, a little bit of frustration, I think, losing the ball like that. But you can see the legs there, they're all tangle, a little kick at each other. A little bit of handbags, isn't it?
Parker, who was recently red carded at Blackburn. Off came Euell and Matt Svensson. Well, we mentioned him, the only man to have scored a goal in getting on for the form completed matches between these two. That was at the Valley last season, it was the winner.
Given the free kick to Charlton, I think that Marinelli might well have been the obvious one there.
Well, 7 minutes to go, and it was late in the game on Tuesday, of course, that Chris Bart-Williams showed his new teammates what he's capable of at free kicks. Southgate's gone back on the line and come out again, all sorts of jockeying for position.
Well, Stamp and Chris Powell, is it? They're smiling. I'd like to think the referee will
do so too. But this is him. Gareth Southgate's anxious to get back on the line to help his goalkeeper. And I always think the danger in that is you attract the players in there and it makes it life difficult for your goalkeeper. Because then all you need is a little touch on it from anyone.
Bart-Williams didn't get it far enough for Charlton. Parker. Oh, and Costa read it just in time and he needed to because Queudrue was trying to counter-attack swiftly for Middlesbrough.
He was left-footed.
He keeps kicking with his left foot. You know as well as I do, he is left-footed, but it hasn't been the best day. And of course, again, it's not an easy day. Once the ball's up in the air, anything can happen. And the windy weather set to continue for a few more days as well. Adding to his 49 minutes of first-team football this season, Matt Svensson. Injuries and suspension, the brown boots. New fashion. Used to be one time ago, they were all brown.
Really?
Before your day.
Exactly.
Did you see that pair in Barry Fry's office Sunday?
Yeah. I thought they were your old ones, mate.
They were Barry's.
This is going to be a really frustrating day for Middlesbrough fans, I think, today to watch. Not a lot's happened for them. It's a point at the moment. It ain't the worst thing when you get two games in hand and you can pick up a point. But I think this would have been a game that Steve McLaren would be hoping to win.
Campbell. It still can be won.
Oh, yes.
Either side and Middlesbrough with memories of those late goals against Manchester United in the FA Cup. Whelan have got the first of them. Shut off there by Fortune. Marinelli. Here's a foul. His first challenge from Parker seemed to be coming from behind.
Well, this has been the most likely avenue, I think, for Middlesbrough. Again, the centre-backs trot over. Again, five and six trot away. Watch the runs as they go into the box. That's the targets.
A goal now would mean so much to Middlesbrough Football Club.
Where was Festa? Southgate asked the question. He went near. He expected Festa to be coming in behind. Same sort of run. He wasn't there.
And Bart-Williams. Get it to an adventurous break from Robinson. Whelan. Marinelli feeding it through to Campbell. He goes down, but Middlesbrough still on the ball with Ince and Stapp. One-on-one with Powell here. Stapp born here in Middlesbrough. Fan of the club as well as an employee of the club, but he hasn't served them very well there. Lisbie. Now Stuart. Robinson. 3 minutes to go, plus added time. This will start from deep with Southgate again. Queudrue.
No, right pass
on the right channel. The only good thing about it is Kiely had to play outside the area. Could have missed kick, but he didn't.
But the pass has been really poor today, Middlesbrough. Oh, what a take.
By Svensson, and his hamstrings are obviously in good working order.
Well, they were before then. This certainly tests them. I think what happens is, well, when it comes down, and OK, it's adventurous, but Chris Powell has actually made a run, Martin, and he's coming down the left-hand side, and he's in. Svensson had just held it.
Marinelli. First time cross by Stapp. Whelan!
Well, I said they'd get a chance in the match. It's been a long time coming, but this is one. It's not the easiest of headers. You can see how he's backing away for it, so it's difficult to get power. I'm still expecting him to do better.
Svensson picking out Stuart. In turn Parker, back to Stuart again. Lisbie has nicked it away from Southgate now. Was he deliberately brought down there? It's certainly not a free kick for Charlton. It's a bit of sympathy for Southgate, I think. Although he's actually off the pitch. Just.
He was a little unlucky, Lisbie, in fact, that he nicks the ball and then, well, he just catches him with the knee and the side of the head. Well, unfortunately, that little clash took place because Lisbie was through and making after the football.
It looks as though a free kick has been given to Southgate. Or is it just a case of restarting the game in the time accustomed manner now?
Well, he certainly didn't blow for a free kick when Lisbie knocked the ball past Gareth Southgate. He only blew when he saw Gareth Southgate not get up. So I guess Charlton have said, oh, you might as well have the ball.
So what should Crossley do here then?
Stand. I'm well at you.
Not kick it out?
No.
Campbell. Seen off by Parker. Robinson. Lucky against the Queudrue. 2 extra minutes. Won't be decisive when the 90 we've had so far. Not.
Well, although I think Charlton have been the better side over the 90 minutes, they still haven't created enough. Haven't made enough chances. I think either team will think they should have won the game. Certainly Alan Kirbishley will be the happier manager of the two. I think, this, as I said, his team's passing has been better. Movement's been pretty good. Steve McLaren said they've struggled all day to find the passing, to find the movement, to find the craft. I think his midfield area might be a problem for Steve. They talk about not scoring goals here, but to score goals you need service. And looking at the midfield again today, it hasn't really created in the way it should at this level.
Interestingly, almost 7,000 more here today than there were for the Manchester United FA Cup tie.
A protest that day, weren't they, about the fact they had to pay for them, not in the season tickets, the FA Cup tickets had to be bought separately, and I think the fans voted with their feet that day.
Last season, these two sides produced one goal between them in the two games this season. Looks as though it's going to be none. But where does life just hope? And there's a free kick for Middlesbrough. And the last chance. There's a booking for Robinson here.
Yeah, he has a lot of nick at him, but I have to say, Queudrue goes down really easily. He collapses like a pack of cards over there. Well, this must be the last chance. We're in stoppage time of stoppage time now.
Marinelli to take it. Whelan. His run has come to an end, but Whelan can look back on the last 8 or 9 games with some real pride. He's reignited his career. Nil-nil at the Valley in October, 0-0 at the Riverside today. A draw that gives a contribution to both managers in their search for survival. That is the main aim for both these clubs. It's a point that takes Charlton above Tottenham to 8th in the table. Middlesbrough stay 16th. Middlesbrough 0, Charlton Athletic 0.
Well, there's plenty more sport to come from Sky Sports this evening. You're here on One at 6:15. There's highlights from the German League, the Bundesliga. It's Bayern Munich against Bayer Leverkusen, followed at 7 by live football from La Liga. Valencia meet Athletic Bilbao. Later tonight on Sky Sports One, there's live coverage of this year's NFL Super Bowl. Super Bowl 36 between the Rams and the Patriots, 10:30. On 2 at 7, there's all the action for today's One Day International between India and England in the World Cricket Centre. And on 3, there's more golf. Coverage of the Heineken Classic is on now. And at 8, we go live to Pebble Beach for the final day of the AT&T National Pro-Am. Gordon McQueen's thoughts when we come back. We'll name the man of the match. We'll hear from the managers and reflect on a difficult afternoon. Middlesbrough 0, Charlton 0. There were no goals here today. It was likely a defender would win man of the match. Here's Claire Tomlinson.
Gareth, was that just one of those games that you had to just grind out?
I guess so. I think Charlton have had a decent season up to now. We just needed to keep things ticking over. We were disappointing, really, today. I don't think I'm too... I'm not with it, really. I got back on the end towards the end there.
Do you have to keep it tight at the back? The defences were on top, really, all game?
I think so. I mean, there weren't really many chances throughout, so... disappointing to drop points, but, we've got to keep scraping points together.
Noel, slim pickings up front for you as well.
Yeah, they didn't give us much space today. The lads at the back, the three of them, have done well. So, not many chances. And the ones that did get, they were half chances, maybe could have done better.
Was it just a question of working hard and trying to find some space?
Yeah, we weren't getting much space, three at the back, it's hard to get away from them. We didn't play good football, to be honest with you, we didn't get the ball down and pass it well. So, we made it hard on ourselves.
After good results against Sunderland and Manchester United, is the feeling today of disappointment, Gareth?
Well, I think home games, you want to pick up 3 points if you can. We haven't managed to do that, but... at least we're keeping a little bit of an unbeaten run going, so we've got to take something from it.
Do you feel you're still anxiously looking over your shoulders a little bit?
We've had a good run. We've not got beaten today, and that's the main thing. We'd like the 3 points, but they came here, and for Charlton have done a job. So, at the end of the day, a draw was a fair result, I think.
Gareth, I know you've got a bit of a headache there, but there is the man of the match champagne. Bart, you have man of the match. Well done.
Cheers, thanks.
Just don't forget to take it home, Gareth. A bit of a struggle, wasn't it? But good pro, isn't he?
Yeah, and he was excellent today. I mean, at least he tried to force things a bit, playing in the back three for Boro, coming out with the ball, and there was a little bit of urgency in his place that wasn't evident elsewhere in the field.
And he's gone straight from that interview to see the doctor because his head apparently is hurting. It was quite a bumpy talk, wasn't it, late on down there?
My head's hurting watching it because it wasn't the best of games, I can assure you. it was a poor, poor game, and I suppose at the end of the day, neither manager can complain about a point. But I felt that it's a home game, for Middlesbrough, it's not one of the biggest they're playing, and you look at the Charlton and you think, well, that's maybe one they should be looking at 3 points, because they are still in trouble. As I keep saying, I expect them to get out of it, but it's a game that you might have thought, well, 3 points, but they didn't deserve it today.
Perspective from Charlton's point of view, here's Chris Powell with Jeff Shreves.
Chris, unfortunately for the neutral, it wasn't very entertaining. Why do you think it panned out like that?
Well, it's two teams that are desperate for points. Obviously Middlesbrough have done well of late. So we knew it would be a difficult game for us, and apart from our win on Tuesday night against Derby, we've had quite a rough time of late, so it wasn't the most entertaining of games, that's for sure.
So in many ways, was it more about not losing rather than winning?
Well, I think so. As the game wore on, I think it was more a case of make sure we don't lose. It's a long way to come for us and our supporters, but we performed well, could have nicked it, but I suppose both managers would be pleased with a point.
Do you feel you had a decent chance yourself in the second half?
Oh, God, yeah. I've already had a bit of stick about it. I don't score too many. And I let myself down with the first touch. But, maybe it should have fell for someone else. But, I'll keep getting in there and hopefully I'll get a goal soon.
What were conditions like out there? Because it looked pretty windy.
It was windy, and the pitches up and down the country aren't the best at the moment. And it was quite bobbly. But, Middlesbrough... quite direct side. They don't concede too many goals, that's for sure. So, we didn't create that many chances, but the conditions and you know, it wasn't the best of games at all. There's not much I can say about it, really.
Best to forget about it, in other words. On a personal note, are you looking forward to the England squad being announced next week?
Well, yeah, you know, a lot of players are looking forward to it. I'm no different. You know, you have to do well for your club, and, you know, I hope that maybe next week as well. We've got a very hard game, Manchester United at home, so, you know, the squad will be announced after that, so hopefully I've done enough to get in.
We wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Barclay Card Premiership, it's a point for Middlesbrough. It might be a big point come the end of the season, and as Gareth Southgate was saying, they haven't been beaten here. Leicester were this weekend. Derby's, it turns out, the only one of the bottom six to pick up maximum points. Bolton Wanderers in front twice at St James's Park were beaten. Blackburn Rovers beaten by West Ham. So Middlesbrough, with a two-point gap between themselves and Blackburn. Now, they do have a game in hand on most, if not everybody else. In fact, it is, isn't it? Everybody else down there in the bottom half. Sunderland falling dangerously. Everton beaten at home by Ipswich in 14th. Southampton making good progress now. If 40 is the safety mark, they're 10 away from that in 13th. Then Ipswich, 6 wins from 7. That's championship form and it's got them out of trouble. 30 points their return now, and the Hammers have hung about most of the season around the halfway mark. Fulham are ahead of them. Spurs can't find a win at the moment, down into 9th. Charlton with their point up into 8th today. Villa stay 7th. Leeds United, beaten at home by Liverpool today, 4-0, stay 6th. Chelsea are 5th with 43. Arsenal down into 4th with 48. Liverpool up into 3rd on the back of their big win. 49 their return from 26 played. In between them and Manchester United, look, Newcastle with a game in hand. They're 2 points back on the champions as well. Manchester United stay top, 51 points from 26 played. Alan Kirbishley is with Jeff Shreves.
Alan, you looked a little frustrated. Looked like you were going to run on the pitch a couple of times.
Well, I was, because, you know, it wasn't obviously the best game in the world, but I felt that we had a couple of chances in the second half that when we broke, if we'd have got an extra pass in or kept it for a little bit longer, I'm sure we'd have got in. But it was poor conditions, you know, the wind and the pitch and everything else. So, you know, we're happy with a point, but I think if we could have played a bit better, we may have got all three.
In some ways, do you feel you were trying to win the game more than Middlesbrough?
No, I know that Middlesbrough over the recent weeks have been very dogged and have managed to grind out results, 1-0s and like they did on Tuesday at Sunderland. And I just felt we had to match that, which we did. We matched up with them, which we did. And I was hoping that we would then get on top. And as I say, we had a couple of opportunities around the final third, but it fizzled out and perhaps sums the game up, really.
In some ways, do you almost feel it's going to go like that? There's nothing you can do?
Well, I think with 10 minutes to go, I think both me and Steve would have settled for the point. You know, it wouldn't have been nice to have got beat, but it would have been a fantastic boost if both of us, you know, would have got the win. But that's another point. As I said earlier, we let ourselves down badly at Blackburn. We've got quite a good away record, and we've picked another point up.
In some ways, is the point even more important? Because next up, it's Manchester United, then Leeds, then Chelsea.
Yeah, but, you know, obviously we've got a tough run of games over the next three, if you like. But if you look at our record, you know, the tough games we've normally done all right in. It's the expectation level, I suppose. But certainly when we've had teams that our fans or we think that we may go and get points, we've found it hard. We have to wait and see. Don't know, no tougher than Man United and Leeds and then Chelsea. But that's what we're in the Premiership for. We're looking forward to it.
Have you been distracted at all about the speculation about linking you with Aston Villa, a bit like the West Ham scenario last season?
Not particularly, because, you know, the West Ham thing obviously was full-blown. And but I'd agreed a contract before Harry had left West Ham. And, you know, I went on and honoured that, and I was quite happy to do so. So, you know, I've signed a long-term contract. But, you know, speculation is normally, you know, reporters and media people, if you like, writing something. But, you know, I'm happy the club wouldn't have signed the contract if I felt that, you know, I didn't want to stay there. But I can't stop speculation. But I have to get on with it.
But you haven't heard anything from Aston Villa? There's been no approach, nothing at all?
I don't think anyone, you know, I don't think that happens, really. You know, if there's anything in it, then I'm sure they'll phone my club. I don't know if there's anything in it.
And if they did phone you?
I'm sure Richard would turn them down.
What would you feel?
Sign a contract and, you know, I'm at the club.
Thanks, your time, Al.
Thank you.
Doesn't matter how many times he takes and subsequently answers those questions, they'll keep coming at the moment, won't they? And presumably until Aston Villa make an appointment.
Well, I've heard Doug Ellis is getting a player-manager, you know. So, no. I mean, you really don't. And you hear all the names of speculation. As we said at the start of the programme, it's no surprise Alan Kirbishley gets linked to all these vacancies, your West Hams. But Are they any better jobs than the one he's got just now? I'm not so sure. Financial restraints, seemingly Aston Villa. Is that why Gregory left? I'm not quite sure, but they don't seem to have loads of money to spend. Not any more than Charlton. So Doug Ellis keeps telling the Villa fans, we've just not got the door.
It's a bigger conversation than we've got time for now, but where are the rash of 40-plus coaches and managers? There aren't that many, are there, knocking about the game?
Well, certainly not. There doesn't seem to be a lot of English ones, that's for sure. It says a lot for the coaching system here, that you've got Houllier at Liverpool, French, and Wenger at Arsenal. I mean, I think in your top six managers, there only is Bobby Robson that's English. And it's like, you go to the Scotland, if you're on about coaches or British coaches, you go to the Scotland job, for example, you know, the three in the shortlist, all foreigners, Scala Trussier and Bertie Vaux, who looks like getting the job. So, obviously, Alan Kirblish is a bit of a rarity in the British football just now, that he's a good young English manager or English coach, and there's not many about.
Thank you for coming. Sorry it wasn't better.
I wasn't doing a lot today, anyway.
Well, you didn't do a lot. Thank you for coming. Pleasure. Appreciate your time, Gordon. Tomorrow, 7:30, we've live football from the Nationwide Conference at Stevenage against Dagenham and Redbridge. That's on Sky Sports 1 tomorrow at 7:30. And Wednesday at 7, Andy, Martin, myself, we're all back. We're off to Upton Park to see West Ham play Chelsea. That, of course, the FA Cup fourth round replay. It'll finish on the night, penalties and all the drama that go with it if we can't separate them in normal and then stoppage time. That's Wednesday at 7 o'clock. West Ham play Chelsea, and it's on Sky Sports 2. Not the best affair here today, I'm sorry to say. And music to go out with, which is rather fitting of the weather conditions of late. I think it's entitled Hurricane. We'll see you Wednesday night. Journeys in mind of places we were.